Welcome to Boiler Room. It wouldn't be us without a little bit of a delay. Sorry about that. So some of you at home may recognise the room we're sitting in, which is itself sitting in purgatory. We're in room one of Fabric, which is currently shut temporarily. Hope that'll be resolved. And we're here to talk about the future of Fabric, the future of nightlife in the UK, and the future of culture in general, which has been under attack pretty severely lately, I think you could say. We're partnering with the NTIA, and we have seven panellists from across the world of music and politics. So, to go round, we have Artwork, who is long-standing DJ, played Fabric maybe 10 to 15 times, Domino's enthusiast. And Goldie, who has played Fabric a ridiculous 110 times in his career. Yeah, really. We have Dan Beaumont, who runs Chapter 10, Dalston Superstore, and formerly Dance Funnel, which I think had its last dance in August. We have Alec Benson, who runs Bloc Festival and Bloc sister venue, Open Street Studios, and he's the one that doesn't hate millennials. We have Cameron Leslie, who runs Fabric. And we have two politicians joining us, Mirik Milan, who is the Nachtburgermeister, the Nightmare of Amsterdam since 2012, who's flown over to be with us today. And Emily Thornberry, who is MP for Islington South and Finsbury and not a Brian Adams fan. So, I think what we should start off with is Cameron, because I think it's only just that we in Fabric go over to you to explain what's happened with the appeals process and what you want to do facing forward and what you want to change.
Well, I think it's pretty well publicised kind of how we've arrived at this point now, and unless there's anything particular you want me to go over there, we're obviously shut as a venue now. We've had our licence revoked, and as at last week we launched an appeal to that revocation. We don't actually have a date given to us yet, although I've just seen some now, so we're probably getting a clearer idea now of the kind of timing of getting that appeal. And that appeal is at a magistrate's level, and that is an appeal against the revocation of our licence. But as has been kind of fairly widely understood now from the campaign that we've kicked off, we feel really strongly about the manner in which the revocation was undertaken upon us and the steps that were taken to revoke that licence and our inability to be able to challenge that within the confined licensing laws, really. So we feel really, really strongly that if that can happen to a venue like Fabric with the resources that we have and the strength that we've got and the conviction that we've got, it's going to be possible to do that to any venue in the UK, given the current guidelines and guidance. So we're actually today, I think it's probably just gone up in line now, we've published a transparency statement on the campaign and the laws that we actually are going to be seeking to try and change. That's quite a big statement to change laws. So it's actually the guidance, the Home Secretary's guidance on the licensing laws that we have put eight, what we believe, serious problems with the law, and they're directly related to our particular case. Each one of those is explained in fairly simple English. We put that up onto our website this afternoon. So that's a fight that we're going to take on now on behalf of everybody that's been putting money into the funding. We're putting out how we're going to utilise that funds. The response has been absolutely amazing. Yeah, I mean, we're less than 4 days into that now, and yeah, it's been overwhelming how you know, supportive people have been from sort of every walk of life, and you know, that's going to be running for the next few weeks, but the intention is to appeal the revocation of our licence and to change the laws to stop that kind of situation happening to us and to any other venue in the UK.
You used the word fight already, and obviously people have different opinions on how to come to consensus on this and how to move forward. Could you describe your relationship with the police as it is now, or has it has been in the past? There's a lot of conjecture over who has what power, who has what say, but there's also been quite clearly like battle lines drawn between Fabric and the police. It would be good to know from your perspective if things deteriorated and kind of what the timeline of that is.
Yeah, I think this is kind of built up now into a myth that we're somehow, you know, we're anti-police, and we're not, and we wouldn't have been here 17 years. We were fantastic partners with them for, you know, the best part of probably 13 years, like first port of call partners. We would be coming up with initiatives together to try and take on the challenges of the nighttime economy and the things that we both faced, whether that was, you know, again, I've kind of mentioned it in the speech there, but, you know, the de Beauvoir estate, they had kids there that they just couldn't get to. They were so troubled, and they were looking for an outreach program to try and get to them. And we set up a number of music sessions here, got the kids down, the police and civvies, and they managed to connect with them for the first time. So when they actually saw them in uniform out on the estate, they related to them in a totally different way. And so we were really progressively approaching ways that we could utilise this space when it was empty to benefit the local community. And unfortunately, with the changes in the police structures, the way that they approach, I think the way that they approach policing now, they got rid of a lot of the licensing sergeants who understood the nighttime economy, understood what it was like at 3, 4, or 5 o'clock on outside this club or any other venue on the streets. And it was very much replaced with a stats-driven performance business. And that isn't always compatible with something like the nighttime economy, which is, you know, drugs, people, cash, alcohol, and any one of those combinations can be really explosive. And even mobile phone theft a few years ago, or mobile phone loss a few years ago, that was the primary concern that the police had in terms of this venue and us stopping them. And our relationship with them was always about trying to take those challenges on. And so as I say, for 13 years, we really didn't have, we were very, very close. And unfortunately, you know, the sad fact of the fatalities that we've had here has just been the decline in that relationship. And it's not been on our part. We're not agitators. We just want to run a safe venue within the confines of the law that we can work with. But unfortunately, I think the, you know, and I've just seen something on the BBC today where they said it wasn't a vendetta, but I just don't buy that at all. When we came out of court, having won that appeal last year, I just don't buy the fact that there wasn't a team, the central licensing team, that were working very hard at getting the objective together to get Fabric at the first inevitable instance that it had of some kind of, you know, sad circumstance like's happened. And so I'm afraid they can say whatever they like at this moment. I'm not going to buy it. I don't think anybody would create Operation Lenore if that was a sensitive approach to not coming in here. And I know the conduct of those officers that night, and that was nothing more than them coming in to get the evidence to fit the objective to actually serve the summary review. And but at that point, Operation Lenore, we had no control or ability to change the inevitable of where we're sitting here. From literally from that night when they came in and did that, the rest of the chain of events have been completely out of our control. And that's what we're trying to seek to change in the guidance of the law by saying that weight of evidence can't be with the police. The councillors can't sit there and take those statements of fact that those individuals are not even present for anybody to cross-examine, even if the councillors had an appetite to cross-examine them. They just take it as a statement of fact. And how can you possibly defend something that you're not even given a chance to defend? You're guilty until proved innocent. And so that is something that we, I think, have to take very seriously as part of the wider context of the decline of nightclubs.
Is that the key guideline that you're going to seek to change, the weight of evidence?
Yeah, it's the weight of evidence on the part of the police and the fact of our inability to be able to do it. It's the process and the interim steps that we were effectively served a summary review on a Wednesday night. On a Friday, they had what's called the interim steps hearing, which is where our licence was suspended. We then had a whole month of being suspended before we got to the hearing. At that point, our licence was revoked. And from that point, we can appeal. But we're doing it under constant suspension or closure. Now, no business, not even Fabric, can even with our prudent governance of the business and the funds that we had, you know, in reserves, when you've got cash burn of, you know, 50, 60 grand a week, it doesn't take many weeks to start burning through your reserves before you start taking on serious lawyers. So no small bar or club is going to have those kind of reserves waiting to be able to weather a situation like that.
So the temporary suspension in itself compromises your ability to conduct the appeal?
It does, that's correct. So that's part of those 8 points. But anyway, people can read that. So
I want to throw over to you, Mirik, because a phrase that you use quite a lot, and I've seen you use in different speeches and kind of like feature published articles, is how can you maintain a culture if you don't have a clue what's going on? It'd be good to understand your role within Amsterdam and how a situation, not necessarily like a one-to-one parallel with Fabric, but how this may have been resolved if you had a better understanding between local government and nighttime operators.
Yeah. So to be clear, I'm not a politician, actually. The Nightmare is an independent non-for-profit foundation, so an NGO. Our goal is that Amsterdam has a dynamic nightlife and a vibrant nightlife. We really want to bridge the gap between the municipality, so the mayor and city councillors, small business owners like nightclubs and festivals, but also city residents. We always say it's by having a dialogue you can change the rules of the game. And so why is it so important to have this dialogue? Because there's the level of knowledge in City Hall is often not the same as which is in nightlife. And why I say you can't penetrate the nightlife, and I always say you can't penetrate the nightlife from your office in City Hall, because I understand that these people don't go out at night and they don't see the value. And of course, everybody here knows that like the value of the nightlife is creating value from a social, cultural and economic perspective. I think we're in a really good position in Amsterdam at the moment. It could have been a bigger contradiction on the night the license got revoked from Fabric the day after two new venues were announced to open in Amsterdam.
Is that Shelter? Huh? Is that Shelter?
Yeah, Shelter and also Claire. One of them has a 24-hour license and the other has a license till 8 o'clock, things we, as with our NGO, helped in to create. But the thing is, we are in a good position at the moment in Amsterdam, but this didn't happen overnight. We really took us like really a couple of years to get through to the mayor's office, to get through to the city councillors and to explain to them what's this value of nightlife. So this is also definitely a big challenge which London will have. But I think which is important in Amsterdam is, or the big difference between Amsterdam and London is that in the end, the mayor of London, of Amsterdam decides if a venue will be open or closed. Will be shut down or not. And looking at like having like 150,000 signatures, having 1,000 letters being sent to the council, it was really a big surprise for me that in the end the answer was no. And I understand that the Dutch are much more sensitive and maybe they like to negotiate a bit more, but I really thought there was more possibilities of just saying no, this is not. So I asked myself, to be honest, did they stood a fair chance to begin with?
I'm absolutely fascinated, Mirik, by you talking about how strong the partnerships and the relationships are with the councillors. And it sounds as though you talk about a period of time of several years almost of bringing the expertise from the nightlife to the government. How did you go about that? What was the...
I think at first, I think which is really important to also show, so I think we proved to the mayor as well and to a lot of people that we are not an organization that will say, okay, we need more parties, more festivals, more everything, you know? We will be an organization that would say, okay, we need a better balanced nightlife.
So you knew when to compromise.
Yeah, of course. And you should not be afraid to make hard decisions or to speak up and say, okay, I think it's now also time that, you know, everybody has to give in. And I think it's also now a moment because nightlife is so important, but also people should take responsibility for themselves as well.
Can I ask you a question?
Of course.
With the relationship between the government and the club promoters and stuff,
yeah,
do the government easily recognise now, or did that take a long time to recognise that these individuals are, for better want of the word, kind of responsible? I think the unfortunate thing with Fabric is that it seems that the local government has just given them the full responsibility of monitoring individuals when it's a very difficult job to do. Because I mean, I'm really confused because I've been coming here for so long. I've gone all around the world DJing. I cannot think of a safer environment to clubbing. The security here, and no joke, and I mean, I remember when you know, this was in the 90s, it was a hedonistic country for parties. And even now around the country, it's kind of like fabric. I was really confused when this first came to fruition. So the relationship between you and the government, do they recognize immediately these individuals are kind of responsible for their own, you know, they're young adults?
Yeah. I think,
how does that work?
Yeah, I think the Dutch have a really pragmatic approach to these kinds of situations. Our focus, or the focus in the Netherlands, is always on harm reduction policies to make people are aware of the dangers, which are of course in going out and drinking, and of course also taking drugs. Working from this harm reduction perspective, you can work together with nightclubs and festivals, and work together with them. For example, I'm gonna show you a little idea. Like, the thing is that, in Amsterdam, just started up a campaign called Celebrate Safe. And Celebrate Safe is a campaign where a lot of nightclubs and festivals, they all stand behind it, and they promote it themselves, that people should be, they should think about what they take in. Like, if it's like 10 beers a night, if it's like 2 liters of cola every day, or an illegal substance. So
encouraging a culture of personal responsibility.
Yeah, I think subcultures will shape mainstream culture. And we, instead of like, maybe like this fabric should have been, instead of like saying, okay, this is the end of fabric and use this pragmatic and open-minded people. You said yourself, you were really helping the community here as well. And I think we should like look at it from a totally from a different perspective. Instead of saying, okay, no, we have to stop this now, use the possibilities which are there to open up this community and to get everybody on board, and to realize that it's not, you know, that it's not normal to take drugs or whatever, but make sure that they are aware of the dangers and focus on harm reduction.
Well, something that you said really casually was, you know, going out responsibility, drinking responsibility, doing drugs responsibility. Like, it was just off the cuff. Because it seems that the government there accept that. Here, it seems they're in denial. The young people in this country are going to go out.
It's the old way of thinking.
You know, and they're going to do drugs in their house and go out and do whatever they're going to do, or whatever it may, drink or drink a litre or whatever it may be. And I think it's almost like so Neanderthal with the local people in those positions that don't go out. I mean, I was really surprised to see a really young nightmare. I was going to see an older guy with a tie on, right? I've got Armin van Helden instead, you know. But I thought, you know, I really think about young people I see coming up. And I'm, you know, I'm not a young guy. And I've seen young people coming up. And I think your approach of just outright, the government accept this. I think that for a country that has got so much culture and they're, you know, strangling their own selves by being in denial that even their own kids might be doing drugs, it's almost like they're in the dark ages. Because the last time I woke up, you know, that was what the fact is of this country. And I think it's a real misguide by the government to be so far in denial, and the local politicians, that it's a very like loose bike chain falling off constantly and putting the onus on club owners and people that really, let's face it, young people want to go out, and they are going to go out, and you can't stop them. And the minute you try and put it back to the street or whatever else, I think fabric, when it was first created, there was such a hole in what, you know, a large club, a super club, if you like, that wasn't like trendy. It catered for everyone as a community service.
But these came about because the government at the time stopped people going into fields.
Stopping going into fields?
They were like, okay, we have to stop this now. And then I remember it stopping. And then people were like, okay, where are we going to go? Okay, put them in clubs. It'll be safe.
It'll
it's
be
much
safe.
Better.
It'll
and
be
then
safe.
Now they're going to shut all this down.
Was that the first reaction to clubs opening after the criminal justice bill?
Well, yeah, because when people have been found cold in a field because of hypothermia or whatever it may be, and illegal raves, and, you know, 20 people get together, it's a rave, let's arrest them all. They realised that that was just going to falter very quickly. And when this is a super club, if you like, it was the first of its kind where every demographic of music was being played, and people, young kids, just want to go out and dance and have a good time and lament or celebrate and do all of those things. And I think I look at New York, $72 million of taxpayers' money to eradicate graffiti, and now it's in galleries. You know, we're going to close all clubs and in 30 years say, this used to be a club. And we all used to go there. They're so behind the times. I think Fabric's community service should be celebrated. And I think that those politicians have really got to change their ways very quickly and adapt to an environment, because none of them 30 years ago could say, what's the population going to be in 2016? And I bet you all of them are going to be way off the mark because it's so populated now. And there's loads more young people going out, listening to different things and just wanting to go out there and have a good time. So I'm really intrigued at how Holland's always had that kind of attitude with weed from the 80s, I remember going there. And it's like, I just feel that this country, for being so culturally displaced, in a sense, that everyone comes here. And when I looked through the Lenore report, the thing that baffled me the most was the witch hunt of trying to find these people. And all we can find is people speaking Cantonese and German and all these different people from different countries coming to this place. That I just feel kind of really saddened by the attitude towards the local government in not embracing that.
Put this to Emily, seeing as you are an actual British politician. Do you think there's validity in what Goldie's saying, that either we've backslid or we're entering a new puritanical age, or generally that your colleagues see culture as something to be controlled, regulated, and maybe even extinguished?
I think that most politicians, we were talking about this earlier, would start on the basis of we need to make sure that we keep people safe. So I think that we have to begin with the fact that two young people died and their lives stopped before they even started. And so a licensing authority will be very, very concerned about that and will want to make sure that any venue that they have is as safe as possible, you know, within an area. And that's what we want, you know, because they wouldn't want to be making a decision and then for more people to die. So the question is, how do you come to an accommodation? So what do we do? And the thing which worried me so much when I was talking to Cameron was the way in which relationships between the licensing police, the central licensing authority, and a great club like Fabric seemed to have broken down the amount that they had, and there seemed to be so little trust. And you know, and it seemed to have gone from being an example of good practice. I mean, in so many ways, it's an ideal club. It's right on the end, right on the edge of a residential area. You know, so you don't get the aggro from the public in the way that you might do elsewhere. It's underground. I mean, I have to say, I still get a lot of complaints from my constituents about your lot coming out and pissing in the streets, and that, you know, has been an ongoing problem throughout. I'm just saying that. You know, of all, I mean, it's a serious issue, but there could be so many more. And so I think that it's a tragedy for a club like this to be closed when you feel as though people need to step back from the brink. They need to step back and they need to say, it's in everyone's interests, and we must not forget the cultural importance of a place like Fabric and make sure that it's allowed to continue, because London is poorer as a result of that. That's, you know, and I also think that, unfortunately, in some ways, decisions like this are made by a different generation to the generation that you see in these clubs. And it's our job as politicians to represent everybody, to represent all generations.
Do you think that the onus and the responsibility, and God rest, you know, the one first and foremost, God rest the families of those people that tragically died. Do you think that Fabric are responsible in some way for that, in that situation?
I think that it has to be a joint responsibility. I hear what you say okay, about individual responsibility, but I think that a venue like this needs to be as safe as it possibly can be. And the question is, how does it become as safe as it possibly can be?
Hang on.
And it does that, boys, by being an example of best practice, by looking around and seeing, you know, who's doing what and what's the best thing to do, and keeping an ongoing discussion with the licensing authority and with the police, and there being some sort of trust. And it all seems to have broken down in my patch, and I don't like it.
Do you know what I mean? Do you think we should be as extreme as have two screening systems, strip young ladies in another room separately from boys, strip them completely, like an airport, And in some cases where we suspect something, or the local government might, or local politician might suspect something, and search them, like really physically search them. Do you think we need to go to that extreme in this society, that we are treating a club like an airport, like they're all self-indulgent terrorists of some sort?
Well, that's what I'm saying, is that you need to come to an accommodation. We need to be sensible, and the only way people are going to be sensible is by, as I say, stepping back from the brink and sitting down and going, okay, on the assumption this club is going to be open, on the assumption it's going to be as safe as it possibly can be, what do we do? Let's talk together and work it out. You can't, obviously, if everyone was to be strip searched, for a start, my local residents would be complaining about the 2,500 kids,
exactly,
you know, streaming
and
out.
And sexual harassment cases or something else.
Yeah.
But I also think that if that's the case then, if that is the case, then we have to look at it from another perspective. And I think the admittance of people doing drugs is one thing. But I do believe that if that's the case, then I'm confused again, because how many 81 drug busts or situations where Fabric have handed over people and done their job dutifully to the police, and I think out of maybe 60 to 80 of them cases, one was prosecuted. Yeah. And I think there's the liability has been moved onto Fabric's owners. And they've done their job. I don't see what else Fabric can do, because they've got stringent security searches. They've caught people. They've handed them over to the local police. And for that relationship, that breakdown, all of a sudden it's moved from the situation where they've done their job and they're not prosecuting. And that's taxpayers' money and they're not prosecuting. So what are Fabric to do?
I think that
responsibility.
I mean, that goes into the sort of whole resources argument, which is you've got the police who are increasingly under-resourced. You've got local authorities who are having their budgets cut, and I don't think they can visualise the longer term cultural, economic, social benefits of clubs, because the main levers that,
because they're under huge pressures.
Well, they should have been a partnership, not the police partnership. They should have been a partnership with Fabric in the beginning, because their pot's getting smaller and smaller in a situation where more people are going out. And I think the local businesses, food business, for example, the local economy of food, is doing really well. So there is an economic night economy going on, which is really healthy, right? And I think that they're not seeing that, and it's almost like they picked the wrong straw and are now backpedaling very quickly.
But the truth is that the law is the law, and that they're not actually doing anything incorrect. It's the law that's wrong.
Yeah,
and that's the problem. Yeah. They're sitting down there and they're saying 155,000 people petition, doesn't matter. 1,000 representations, doesn't matter.
Okay,
licensing conditions, well, they've been broken.
Well, the law's the law.
The law's the law.
If I get caught in the street with a bag of E's, I'll get arrested. I'll not get just let off, do I? But here, these people get caught and they get taken out.
But therein lies the hypocrisy of the whole situation, and for us, the frustration of what was in those witness statements and the fact that that was considered an association with serious crime. If we'd caught any one of those individuals, we wouldn't have even needed to hand them over to the police. There was no crime reports, and yet those witness statements are deemed to be the trigger.
This is what I mean. This is what I'm getting.
Closing
at the point I'm getting.
A venue of this size and 250 people losing their jobs. It's just, it's wrong.
But if it is on the basis of safety and keeping people safe, 10 people die a year from horse riding. Why don't you stop that? You know, it's like, it's not. It's.
But that's the demonisation now.
Yeah.
And it just, it's amazing that we've gone backwards that far when 10 years ago, we were making so much progress, and it has gone backwards now to a pre-Fabric time.
Mirik used the phrase earlier, harm reduction, which is such an important cornerstone of all venues policies. And we seek to reduce harm, and you can see in the excellent working practices that are established in venues like Fabric that harm is reduced, and measurably so. Perhaps what the licensing law has an unrealistic expectation of is the elimination of the risk of harm, which is not something that happens in real life. It's not something
that
you can do.
It's not real life at all. It's not real life at all.
But we can and do effectively reduce harm in partnership with the police and by adopting these working practices, which have seen us through 14 years of excellent relationships with the authorities within Fabric's case.
And I think the other problem is that if venues like this do close, and if this isn't an option for youngsters, then they'll just, we'll just go back to the old days.
They're going to go back to the old ways.
Of the illegal ones that didn't have any license, didn't have any regulation, you know, and we do not want that. And, you know, I don't want basements on the Cali Road being taken over for the night, you know, with people who don't, you know, who don't, are not answerable to anyone. I don't want that.
I've seen there's a big thing where you have the community, and then you have the policing. And I've seen it happen on estates where you have the community falls apart, they close the school and closures and reductions and everything else. And then you have SR19s or 18s, they go in there, it's a right and that's it. There's no grey area, there's no place where there's a buffer. And I think the club or youth clubs and community centres, which it really is a community centre in that sense, right? With 7 million people over 14 years, 17, right? Million people. Tragically, a couple of people have got a past, which is unfortunate, and our hearts go out to those families. But in terms of weighing that up, that's a really quite minimal in terms of, you know, a place where people go to celebrate music with a high velocity, you were saying, security, skirmishes, people, knife crime. I don't think there's anything that's ever happened here.
This is really the problem with the drug issue, because it's filled with emotions always. And this is what we always say, is like, treat people with facts instead of emotions. And really, when it comes to nightlife, it's so important to look at these facts, and to like what the NTIA has always said, we have to win hearts and minds to make sure that people are aware of this, what's really going on. So that also the level of knowledge rises in these councils, to make them aware of the value that it creates and the opportunities that are there. And I think there's some good work being done with the Loop in the UK, for the first time thinking of, okay, so if we're really looking at harm reduction, so what can we do? And of course the Netherlands has a really good results with drug testing, and I think it's important just to get it out there, you know, to speak about it, because this is really what it's about. And I mean, I understand that's way too
adopted by Greater Manchester Police and Police.
Well, the other thing as well, let's face it, not everyone, that's 17 million, we could probably half it, because not everyone just does at a club. I'm sorry, but they don't. It's not everyone, and I think that the quote was that, well, there's no knife crime and gun violence because everyone's happy. I mean, that is just ridiculous to say that.
Well, that was in a closed session. That was something I told you earlier, because, and that hasn't been widely publicised. And when we actually made that fact that surely in this day and age, no knife crime and no history of violence over 7 million people, in the current climate, you would have thought that would be something to be celebrated. But actually, the insinuation was that everybody is so loved up and happy and wandering around with this kind of dazed look upon their face. I mean, it's just like anybody here who knows this venue knows that it's just not a picture that they see in here at all.
I mean, I think in the 90s I saw that in the fields, do you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, exactly.
I think we are in agreement that basically there's a gigantic hypocrisy, and we're not going to get a satisfactory answer out of what happened to Fabric, because ultimately it's a model of best practice that was used as an example. And there is, like, between airport level security checks and, like, the actual facts and figures, the amount of people that have died in the premises over 16, almost 17 years, ultimately it has been made an example of, and there isn't a satisfactory answer to be gone out of this. I mean, hope the appeal goes through, but I suppose why we're gathered here is to kind of throw forward to how to affect the situation in future. Not to dismiss it, but... I mean, Emily,
I'm not that sensitive.
In an ideal situation, if someone was to appeal for a license and open a new venue here in Islington South and Finsbury, what could they possibly do at a point where there is a disjoint of trust between local government authorities and nightlife operators? What could they possibly do to kind of smooth the process and start on like a steady foot?
Well, there's a big dilemma. There's a big dilemma, because drugs aren't legal here like it is in Ireland, in a sense.
No, drugs are not legal
in
Ireland.
I'm saying certain types of drugs are legal in Ireland, right?
Yeah, so you can take weed, but of course you will also get a
criminal
record.
How does the testing, I mean, the only thing it comes back to is this testing thing. How does this testing process with something that's illegal, it's almost like a gun amnesty, like you show me a gun and you go, you know what I mean? It's like, how does that really, how is the drug testing implemented in Holland? How is it implemented in
Drug testing is implemented. You can go to a testing facility. You can't test front of house, which was done in Manchester. So you have to, like, back of house, this meaning during the day, during office hours. You bring in a substance, you test anonymously, so you don't have to give your ID or anything. Almost like 50 to 60% of the time you get a result straight away, because then the substance is in the database. And if it's not, then you have to wait for a couple of days till you get the result, so you know what's really in it. And what's the good thing about it is that now the Dutch authorities are really well aware of what the drug market is at the moment. So if there's a bad batch of pills or anything, there immediately will go out red alerts to all the clubs, to all the festivals, and they will hang up signs that people should be aware of these substances. And also, like, when you give people information about what's inside a substance, they're more likely to throw it away if they know like 40% of this is something which is really not good for you. So people will be much more aware, and they will listen much more to what you have to say about this substance. And I think like the results are really good, but it's just like the solutions are maybe easy, but the way to get there is really difficult.
The youth in this situation in the UK, mm-hmm. because the example, how do you think, what would be your overall view of what the going forward now,
yeah.
another situation.
Yeah.
Do you think that the law itself should be changed in terms of the liabilities and everything else involved with people's, you know, individuals?
Yeah, of course. I could say yes, of course. I would like that because I support Nightlife, and I hope Nightlife can thrive in the future. I think the biggest problem at this moment is that the councils they're in charge of all the licensing, and I think to have a wider strategy of London. So what is the strategy of London when it comes to nightlife? And I think it's great that Sadiq Khan is now the mayor of London, is now finally saying, okay, we have to support our late night culture. And I think that's really important. But the thing is that getting all the councils aboard and letting them understand that the value of nightlife is not only that there's a big value in it, and also I think like what always helps in the drugs debate is that like people like Kofi Annan and Richard Branson are joining this conversation and also saying there's been 100 billion dollars has been spent on the war on drugs and nothing has changed. And I think this is an important thing. So we have to really look at this in a different way to keep our children, to keep our community safe.
Can I just pick up on what you were saying about Sadiq and the you know, the nightmare? Because I do think it's really important. I think having a relatively small local authority struggling with an issue as big as this is really difficult for them, I suspect. And I think that it is something which is a bigger policy. And I think that having a London-wide policy and having a mayor of London who will be able to take a lead on this, so that it isn't just a relatively small local authority that's taking on the central licensing authority of the Metropolitan Police centrally, you know, who sweep in as experts and we deal with licensing up and down the country and we can tell you that this is the worst, I mean, whatever, you know. I think that it is something we definitely need to have dealt with on a London-wide basis and be able to take it on the basis of what is good for London, Londoners as a whole, what is good for our standing internationally, and how do we make sure that we remain, you know, a cultural capital whilst keeping our people safe as best we can.
But that can only happen by law change, can't it?
But it can also happen by way of having a mayor who stands up for London as a whole and who's strong enough
yeah.
to do that.
But in our instance
he's
there...
He's unable to make a difference. He's definitely commented positively, but the way that the licensing system is set up is that all decisions relating to licensing are taken on a local borough level. There isn't a mechanism by which a citywide politician can influence that process.
Well, no, there is. There is. In that the metropolitan is that the person responsible for leadership in the Metropolitan Police is the mayor.
Because it had been triggered on us, he had no say because it had already
that piece of paper arrived on his desk prior to it triggering the summary review, he could have possibly sat down with all parties concerned. But because that went straight in and was triggered, he couldn't then get involved.
General policy direction can be given by the Mayor of London. And so
that's, in terms of the police's actions
yeah,
in this
so
case.
So that's really important. Could and I so ask, it is really important
can I, sorry, can
that
I just
Sadiq has somebody has
trying to get
this.
A word in.
I mean, what I was going to say was that the sharp end of the decision making is still three local councillors, and those three councillors ultimately in a licensing hearing, they are the people who make the decision, and the certainly the mayor can try and influence the police's position on it, but ultimately it's three councillors who make the decision. And I think actually this feeds back to what you were saying about how crazy it is that this kind of cultural heritage that we're kind of all talking about is sort of resting in the hands of people who might not be fully understanding the impact of their decision making.
Do you think that certain larger decisions on license, such as the momentous one that affects fabrics, shouldn't be taken on a borough level and should be taken on a city?
Well, I agree with Emily. There must be a London plan, because we all agree that this is a really, really crucial cultural resource.
The repercussions have gone way beyond, isn't it?
Well, as things stand at the moment, who's going to invest in the next great club for London? Like, who is going to be doing that? Because you'd be watching this and you'd be thinking, this is crazy. But we all know, I mean, obviously everyone in this room knows what huge impact club culture can have, not just on like young people, but on culture as a whole, and how it kind of informs music, writing, art, you know, fashion. It's really, really important.
To take the example of fabric, it's not like this is a little warehouse playing donk music. No offence to donk. It's like the people who've played here have founded genres, have fostered movements. You've had people like Jos Peterson and John Peel play here. It's literally like the backbone of British culture. And for people to be so myopic and see it as a problem that needs to be extinguished is just ridiculous. Because this is our greatest cultural export, right?
You think it's a big fish in a little pond in terms of the local? I think the local law has been set. A very old law, I guess. I'm not sure how one of these laws were established. But the actual bigger clubs, bigger places.
The Licensing Act is 2003, and the actual intention of the Licensing Act when it was brought in was to liberalise licensing in the UK. And the idea was that we were going to have 24-hour licences, cafe culture, and it was going to have, you know, this transformative effect on our sort of leisure industry. But
the end of netting it at closing time.
Yeah. A more kind of European outlet.
And the enforcement of that is where it's gone wrong.
Well, the problem
in my
is,
opinion.
Yeah,
what is the
problem?
The execution
of that, because, you know, that situation, I know it said that we were sitting there for 7 hours during that process, but ultimately we had 30 minutes to defend ourselves against whatever the other side was saying, which we couldn't cross-examine. But ultimately we just had to sit there and pour out in a kind of, and well, they're looking at their watches, that a business of 17 years, £10 million, 250 staff, you're given 30 minutes to the point to it. And also, you know, it's no, again, no disrespect to it, but a butcher, a baker, a candlestick maker are sitting there ruling in judgment for a closure of a business. And that's just no triumphant.
Do you know what? I'm not having that. Yeah, I'm not having that. I think,
really?
No, I'm not having it. It's like, you know, if when you go to a trial, you know, and you have a jury.
You have a jury.
You have 12 people. You have 12 butchers, bakers, and candlesticks makers. There's nothing wrong with that.
Mine was in front of the judge.
There's nothing wrong with that. No.
We
I'm
were
just
in front
saying,
of the judge in the appeal last year.
Listen, I agree with a lot of what you say, Cameron. I'm just not having it. I'm not having you say that councillors have no standing because they might be butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers. That's kind of the strength. They're supposed to be there as representatives of the people. The difficulty might be, I think, that whilst it's good that you have people who are there as elected representatives of the people, they do need to bear in mind they are representatives of all the people. And that's what they need to remember.
They don't represent young people, do they?
And they have to represent all generations and all backgrounds.
But they don't represent young people.
And that's the issue.
Well,
that's the issue.
But therein lies the
that's
problem.
If
there were more turnout in local elections, then they could probably represent more
that's
people.
That's the issue.
I don't think those people on that panel, my dear, actually have an inkling of what culture is at all, and I think that their idea of clubbing was really way back then, a long time ago. And I think with any society, culture does what it says on the tin. You adapt to its environment, and I think that the local authority has not adapted to the environment.
I'm not defending the decision, but the law itself gives no. You can't talk about the cultural value of a venue in a licensing hearing. And I think this goes back to Cameron's point about the actual structure of the law.
We're
That's one of the points that we do. That's one of the eight principles, is that you're sitting down, they're only looking at the negatives. It's only the negative aspects of why you're sitting there. And you're literally sitting there like a naughty schoolboy, feeling like I've done something wrong, I'm in trouble, and I'm really a bad person leading a bad company. And actually, when you take the 155,000, those thousand letters of representation were the only, literally at some points, were the only thing that was keeping me going sometimes. I was literally reading them thinking, do you know what? I really actually now understand and believe in what this fight is about and what this business is about when you're getting caught up in lawyers and legals. And the fact that those positive aspects, the important things, the charities that were writing about, the fact that we were putting on deaf children's raves here, programs getting young musicians who can't hear that have now been taken out, musicians that are on their path to moving on their careers, developing themselves, none of that is taken into account, is surely a backward view on dealing with a premises and a venue and an entertainment space that has those kind of far-reaching cultural
impacts. Would you say then that in this example, if you've changed the law and kind of moved it out of really tight parameters that you need to operate within, and if you changed attitudes, that would kind of solve the backsliding of where we are? You know, 35 to 40% of clubs have been closed since 2007. We're clearly in like a dip. Do you think an attitude change and a law change will affect
it? We're in a city with a village mentality locally. That's kind of the problem here. It's a very village closed mentality of what the local law really
is. Sure, but that would be the attitude change. Let's see if attitudes change in a few years.
It will affect the legal forces that are in play. I think that there's a deeper economic and financial model that is flawed within London now. Yeah. And I do not think, outside of something like the ministry, I cannot think how you could develop and build a new standalone venue the size of Fabric in 2016 or in the forthcoming time. No investor, you're not going to raise money through a bank, so it'll be a private investor to the tune probably £12 million that is going to have to risk his or her own money or collective of monies to be able to start a venue, to then have the economic forces to fill that venue every single Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And if you start having a bad night or a run of bad nights, you're over. The licensing forces and restrictions are just one element of it, but the actual economic model of it in central London now, and with developers, and I know there's been big play about Fabric's going to be turned into luxury flats, and I think that's just a distraction, but the reality of why would a landlord want to give that venue to a club over developing it for something that's going to yield him far greater returns.
You were saying that the government work with clubs.
Yeah. So I think also for the future, which is really important, is that what we did in Amsterdam is that we focused on quality. So Amsterdam now has 10 24-hour licensed venues. And what was pretty radical when we started this project in 2013 is that we focused on the quality of the venue, on the content. So it was not that you would have to get this permit, it was not like you had four walls, a roof and a bouncer in front of the door. It was about the content of the venue. So these venues are all multidisciplinary venues. They have like a bar, restaurant, gallery space, some even have a gym. And it's not about doing one thing 24/7, it's about 24/7 uses of these buildings. And I think it would be really good for, Fabric is a international well-known brand. It's an international well-known brand, so it should be in the international strategy of London. And this is with a lot of nightclubs as well. And so focusing on quality and getting this golden standard of how to run this club from a social side, but also from a content side as well.
How about the notion of a designated area where we can expect for those kind of developments to take place? And maybe we could look at not just a venue, but instead the area which surrounds it, which is conducive to working with the venue. We always hear as licensees about framework hours. I know that it's affected Dan's business very much in Dalston. What about an area within London which is designated for regeneration, which has a framework hours of 24 hours?
But this was that area, wasn't it? This area was beginning. It's like going backwards again, because that's what this was created for, it seems. And I think that I said the question about you working with the government.
Yeah.
Did you feel, Cameron, at any time that these people in this 30 minutes that you got were actually working with you?
Yeah, I do. It would be a disservice to me to say that I felt they were all not against us. I, you know, it's probably unfair to start singling individuals out, but I thought there was some balance in there, and I thought there was the absolute opposite extreme where mind was already made up, and I felt that was the very hard forum to be able to present or defend against the evidence that had been presented against us, and to be able for us to be able to get over in only 30 minutes between myself and our lawyer the whole history of what this venue is and what we do and our operations. I mean, I could probably just talk about our search procedures in 30 minutes, and that was one of however many facets of the operation that were under the microscope in that session. So it just it was not a fair environment to be able to defend yourself.
Cameron, have you lost faith entirely?
Have I lost faith?
You're saying that it's basically close to impossible to be able to replicate this in London in 2016. What hope for the future?
If you said, would I go out and start a new venue in London, the answer is firmly no. So if I've lost faith in that as an industry, then wholeheartedly.
Does that mean that this is close to a full stop for London club culture? If no,
the damage has been done. The damage has already been done. By them doing this, it's already been done. There will be no more investment in clubs in London. And if this isn't saved, it will be... very seriously, like
do you agree?
I think the damage is deep and severe and very real, and I recognise it. But I opened a club in 2013, relatively recent, modern era. It's gone quite well. It's quite busy at the moment, and we're still enjoying the same excellent partnership that Cameron used to enjoy with the authorities. Part of what has sustained Bloc in Autumn Street is its very close relationship with the regeneration of several buildings which surround it, which we turn into a community for people working in the creative industries. Their businesses make use of the club space during the day, during the week. We invite the local residents association to come and take part. And I'm teaching my grandmother to suck eggs. Cameron knows all about this, and the relationships that we build very and work very hard at with the council and the local police. I see a future for mixed-use developments in London. I think that there can be various proof of concepts. I certainly feel that our development is a proof of concept. And were we to be allowed to do what the artists and what the nightlife operators did in the wastelands of Farringdon many years ago, or Shoreditch more recently, or Hackney Wick more recently still, if there are areas which badly need investment and which badly need people to visit them and spend money and have jobs, I would put my hand up and I would say to the local authority, oh, mixed use arts studio space here. If you promise me that if there's a Black Swan event, you recognise my professionalism, you recognise that we can reduce harm, we can't eliminate the risk of harm, if you'll work with me, I'll take that risk.
But you've got to make sure in 15 years' time that when you've kind of anchored a site, and that ripple effect of growth and development in that area, turning it from that wasteland into the next hipster's hangout, and then those become now £500,000 flats, and then in a few years' time, your crowd have actually become your opposition. Mm. It's those changing faces in the local authorities. It's how are they going to be, how are you protected when you've been building that
else, you've done the dirty long work. You've done the dirty work. As I see, well, I had seen it happen with Hudson Square. We did the dirty work. We built the clubs. People came, and everyone profited from that. And the backhanders and all the people that got sorted out. And all of a sudden, it's over for you guys because this has happened, and tragedies have happened. But I think the onus is on individuals as well. And I don't think that people are responsible within this structure of fabric. They've done as much as they can possibly do. But once that happens, and you move it out and you build those flats, what next? Culture's got to pick itself up and go somewhere else. Culture's built on foundation.
I hear you, but I'm not as pessimistic as you. I think there's been a mistake made about fabric, and I think that it is not the end. I think people can step back from mistakes, and I think they can think again. And I think you just need to find a bit of compromise, and people need to
lift their
eyes up and think about what is actually best for London. And I think if people do that, then we do have a future.
But if you take fabric aside, I think the picture in the last 10 years, fabric isn't London nightlife. You look 10 years ago and the landscape and the amount of clubs we had in London, and look at it now in 2016, and it's a totally different picture, and that's got nothing to do with the situation at Fabric. That's to do with the inward investment and seen as this being an attractive business, whatever the passion is. You can't build a £12 million club just on passion. That has to be built on some very solid business foundations, and I question whether those big clubs have a place in London going forward.
With the law being the way that it is now,
law
basically.
Or economics, yeah. I think that's...
Putting aside, obviously, the loss of 250 jobs in fabric, audio technicians and bar staff, the record label and everything, putting aside that that is obviously a terrible thing, do you need a club of this size? You
where, do where, yeah, but where are young people? Where are you? Yeah, where are young people going to go? That's the question I want. Where are young people now? My daughter's 18. She goes out. She went over to this other little rave the other night. Come back, had a great time. You know, it's culture. She's getting part of that culture. Where are they going to go? Because let's look at the 250 people that have lost
their
jobs.
It goes back underground, surely, right?
But I don't think it can, because it's all about dispersing, and I think those people are going to go, I've lost all faith with music. I want to go back to shotting or just getting into trouble, because that's what it is. I think there's people forget, the young people coming up, there's a road and you go, I love music. You know what? I'm not going to break into a car tonight. You know, I'm going to go to something else. People do that. I made that decision. You know what I mean? I've got a son who made the wrong decisions. God bless him. Because, you know, I look at that model and I think you took the community out of an estate. You're ripping the heart out of London when you rip the heart out of fabric, because it's the heartbeat of what, you know, people in those offices don't understand this, and they won't. It's like Spock, no emotions. They don't get it, because you need young politicians, young-minded night managers. People are going to adapt to the culture like you have. That, you know, from an NGO as well, that people respect the position. And I know that if we had a night manager that was supported by people donating to a night manager that can have a safe liaison with the government, it would probably be successful. But they don't want to give those jobs up. They don't want to give that position up, because they're very healthy and wealthy by sitting back, having no idea, falling asleep in a meeting, not really understanding what real culture is. And that's a big problem, because it's not now or tomorrow or next year when it's going to affect this country. It's going to be 5 or 6 years down the line when it becomes riot police going. You can't go into certain areas or certain places because you've been pushed out. This situation with fabric is creating a safe haven for young people to go. I'm standing in fabric and I've got a guy who's a designer, a skateboarder, a dread, do you know what I mean? A yardie. People are different people that share cultural ideas and job spec. You know, the amount of work I've got through just people that you meet, that really company, what it's the fabrication of what that work is. Not just we went out and did a happy pill, as I like to think, but we actually got on with the business side of it, and there's certain exchanges from different, you know, backgrounds. And that's really important. And I think that we are killing, and they've really got to wake up quickly, because it's the same thing with the loose bike chain. Before it's too late, guys. They've got to really wake up and understand it's culturally important.
Artwork, sorry, you haven't said something for a while. So.
No, I think
he's got his own mic.
I think that there is something about a room of this size that you don't get in a. You can have small clubs of 300 people. They're amazing. They're, you know, but there's something about this many people in a room with this good a sound system and lights that is its own thing. Do you know what I mean? It's very rare.
We should aspire to produce that in London.
There's only a few in London. There's only, you know, there's a handful worldwide that are like this. And it is a piece of art, if you like, when you go along and get involved in that experience of being with 1,000 or maybe 2,000 people on that same vibe in the room with the listening to great music with a good sound system, and it's safe.
Rewind a little bit what you're saying. Plumstead, Triangle, you know, Half Moon Club, you know, Jazzy B, Norman J, Giles Peterson, small clubs. We came through. Everyone came through. Howie B, coming through small clubs that were week in, week out, changing what we were thinking in terms of longevity and growth. And when you see the same people, you get on a train, we see the same people in the same carriages. If you go to work 9 to 5, pretty much the same people. And they kind of claim the same seats, and they kind of nod, or you don't speak to each other, whatever else. You come to a club every week, a fabric, and you have a respect for different people because you see them every week. So you go to a festival, you don't give a fuck and throw your rubbish everywhere. Which I've seen in the festival mentality, it's like, let's just serve them and sell as much as we can and just get a good clean-up campaign and get everyone be plastic bags picking up after each other after. Shouldn't be that. And the bespoke festivals are changing the way that they think because they're going, let's clean up after ourselves. Fabric have already cleaned up for London by creating an environment. Do you know what I mean? Where we there's a community, we can get on with each other. And that is something that grows over time. All the small clubs closed. And then that's why Fabric kind of got created, because like one big place where we kind of feel safe together in numbers. And if that's going to be, if that's going to take a dive.
But
it's
also,
just
I think that London needs that spectrum. It needs middle, small. It needs everything for everybody to be able to enjoy. And I think that if that model disappears at a large scale level, you lose the scale of budget that allows a venue like this to put on 25, 30 artists a night, flying 15 of them in from Europe and Berlin or wherever it may be, to be able to put that on, to be able to give people that opportunity for £20 to come and see artists from all around the world on that night. It's a mini festival in the centre of town. And if that disappears, then your offering as a global city is suddenly reduced. And London, really?
But it's an ecosystem, isn't it? And I think the thing about Fabric, or having that big club, a lot of operators, smaller operators like me, we all aspire to Fabric, not just in terms of programming and things like that, but in terms operationally, you know, having an example to follow is really important and powerful. But also on the other side, a lot of people have come through Fabric and opened their own small venues. And I think...
all the countries as well.
Yeah, and so I think London should have a big club that everyone can aspire to, that in turn generates other venues and other kind of creative endeavours. And I think if a capital city like London doesn't have these big outposts that support culture, and also when you if you've got a capacity of 1,500, 2,000 people, that gives you resources to support culture in different ways. And I think not having those big clubs would not make London, I mean, back to the licensing argument, I wouldn't make London safer. Not having those examples of best practice would be detrimental to the small underground clubs as well.
That's a contrast that people pulling now of what happened to New York from the late 90s throughout post 9/11 era and into where we are now, where it is bland, basically. It was the most exciting musical city in the world, and that was bland. And people are drawing comparisons between, obviously, Berlin, which is just designated Berghain, I think, a cultural centre, which means you get better.
I know so many people that have moved there because they say it's the only place we can go for music now. And I think it's so sad, but I mean, my question to what your opinion on this. Do you think it's just an agenda where they go, the local government are going, we're not going to hand out any more licenses because we've got to shift this. We don't like clubs. We actually don't like clubs. And I kind of think, is that part of the agenda, do you think? Is it a thing where it's shifting from, we'd rather give a food license, we don't want to give a club license because, you know, we don't get a part of that?
I think it's risky. And I think that people would always prefer to play safe unless they got a good reason not to. I think that, you know, the Metropolitan Police would rather ban a demonstration than allow it, because all these people turning up and marching down the street, they'll probably be trouble. Mm. So they need to have a good reason why that's not right. Okay, so I think you have to kind of keep putting forward the argument, and you have to make sure that you do, so that people do understand that this is checks and balances. This is, you know, people must be allowed to congregate together. They must be allowed to celebrate things. They must be allowed to have a large party. They must be allowed to demonstrate. They, you know, and we need to make sure people are kept safe. Mm. But the answer is not to lock everybody in their bedroom.
Mm. Well, I mean, I think that you're saying about keeping them safe. I mean, Fabric have really... I mean, even when we get searched, and our egos are bigger than anyone's.
Really?
We get searched. We get searched like anyone else. And I think that's probably the only time I ever got searched in the club. But I think it's really... I mean, I got turned around the first night we came here. You know that?
I know.
First night I came here, I got turned away. And it's just grabbed me down the street. I got turned away from Fabric anyway. But it's... I think when you look at the... You know, the... Yeah. But the idea of trying to keep this going, and I'm trying to think, I'm optimistic with it.
Are you?
I am optimistic because I think that the hearing is the hearing, and you go through the normal situation and the paper we've seen, and I've read the Lenore and everything else. But I think when it does go into the cold light of day with the judge, if a motor, if a guy's driving down the street with a car and knocks someone over and it's manslaughter, they didn't mean to do it. This, you know, this situation happened and someone died. They didn't mean to do it. I'm sure that you rewind the clock, they didn't mean to do that. But it's not like Fabric just stepped in the road and not looked both ways about what's going on here. And that's really important, because I think when it gets to a high court, it's like the evidence, what evidence to revoke a license, it seems like it's a witch hunt. I almost feel like I wanted to get Keith, the owner of Fabric, and drown him and say, well, if he lives, he's a witch, let's burn him. And if he drowns, then he was, you know, he's guilty, isn't he? Because it just seems that kind of witch hunt, where I'm trying to look at whether in the normal society where there's law and the law upholds us and keeps us safe, the law for me has got to change, because you're trying to pin the tail on something. There's no evidence of that. You know what I mean? And to be honest, let's face it, kids and guys out there, 9 times out of 10, people out there that do drugs, they do it at home and come here or come somewhere else. It's not a thing where I think, you know, doing drugs in clubs sometimes for a lot of people ain't safe anymore. You don't know what you're getting. Do you know what I mean? So there's that aspect of it.
Mirik, I'm going to unfortunately put quite a lot of weight on your shoulders, because a lot of people in London look over to Amsterdam as a model of what we could be if we reverse this trend. You look at areas like the school, where you have a 24-hour license and they do a variety of cultural activities in the day and have a really fucking great nightclub in the evening, as well as shelter opening during ADE. And just the general atmosphere is something that people look quite fondly to. In your opinion, what, because if we can't change law immediately and attitudes won't be an immediate change either, what could London do over the next 5 to 10 years to slowly get towards a point where we stop the backsliding, we move forward again? Because we need to kind of get some kind of solution.
I think more power for the mayor. That's to start with. Having a strategy for the whole of London, where they want to go to. Creating behavioral change with people that go to venues, but also a change of behavior, or maybe a change of how councils look at nightlife. Making sure there is some kind of integrity for nightclubs because they are really often used for placemaking, like what Fabric has done here as well. Some kind of integrity. Install the agent of change principle. So if there is a nightclub, make sure that the project developers, that they pay for isolation of the venue. That's a really important thing coming also from San Francisco. And is more, which is really important to install here as well, and creating this golden standard. What is a multi-purpose venue? What does it look like? And if you check all these things, if you have all these things in your venue, then it will be more difficult to revoke a license if something goes on, because these problems, they sit in society, and it's not a problem of the venue.
Is that what you two think as well? Given that you're a current club owner and potentially return to starting a new space soon?
Yeah, I mean, I think the change has to come from all sides in a sense. I definitely agree that the law needs to change. The Licensing Act is, I mean, it had quite a light shone on it at that Fabric hearing, and it's pretty troubling the way it all played out. I think a plan for London, we have to have a plan for London. It's crazy that we don't, and that we don't have some kind of unified approach to licensing. But I also think clubs need to innovate and need to keep changing, and I think need to continue finding better partnerships with the police, with local authorities, but also try and diversify what they're offering to communities a little bit more, and think outside the box in terms of what we do. I mean, I'm on the stage of two people who have done that and are doing that. So it's not like there are no examples of it.
I think one of the most sort of profoundly unsexy answers to the whole thing is planning policy. If we can decide that we're going to have an area where we recognise on a citywide level that we need venues, that they're really great things, that they're forces for cultural good, so right, we'll allow the venue to work in conjunction with what our plans are around it, and we're going to make sure that we value that, and that's where you can maybe get that security that you're talking about.
And you then link it in with the underground, which is going to be open all night.
Absolutely.
And so, you know,
so there's infrastructure that should serve it. It feels like the will is there and it's bubbling underneath. We have a mayor who is vocal about supporting nightlife, 24-hour tube offering as infrastructure. We certainly have underutilized buildings in London. We're a densely populated city. They do exist and they're not that far away. We can build our little utopia out somewhere.
Well,
can be done.
The infrastructure for Fabric is already there and it's quite tested.
I don't disagree about the value of fabric. I think it's really important to keep it, but I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. That's all. There is a future.
Well, that's the thing. Fabric's operational structure was exemplary, and it was.
I don't understand what more fabric can do in that sense, which kind of baffles me, because we can say we can build another place and an area and build another club, but the people that run it and everything else, and I think the individuals that go to that place, you have so much control over those individuals. When you've got people in your club, I mean, how much control do you have over people coming
in? This is very true, and this is what we were talking about earlier. Feeling as though you have the sword of Damocles hanging over your head in the event of something which you cannot control is a terrible position for a business to be in. It's not one which is conducive to a stable business or to the future of a business. But there are things that can be done. You can nurture partnerships. You can nurture relationships. You can make rules. You can make policy, planning policy specifically, which encourages that you can be somewhere for a long time. And we can, hopefully, Cameron can influence the way that licensing works so that we don't end up in this situation again.
Throw a spanner in the works.
Where a black swan event ends up making
throw a spanner in the works, a big spanner in the works. As a politician, let's look at it the other way around. Do you think we should have drug testing to see if people have done drugs and then they can get entry into a club? Question.
I'm not really here to talk about drug policy today.
No, I'm here but I'm to talk the, about, I think the whole point
about
of the lot, yeah.
And what I really want to do is talk about practical measures that will, in the immediate, in the now,
but that's what
save
I'm saying.
Our night.
That's a measure, isn't it?
No, but I think that you know, our national drug policy is something that is certainly something we should debate, but I don't think that it's going to give you your answer this year or next year.
But it's the point
I think
I'm trying
what we
to make,
need
yeah.
in terms of the crisis now yeah. is we need to have like immediate answers now. And when you were talking a bit earlier about, you know, building relationships, I thought it was really interesting, Cameron, that, you know, when you were talking about the hard to reach kids on the estate that you were working on, it wasn't an Islington estate. It's a shame. Because in the end, you know what I mean? It's like, and you're right, you need to make friends. Need to just continue to have friends with the local authority, and not immediately with the licensing authority, but just to be seen to be a positive thing.
But you know what our relationship is with the local licensing authority.
No, but
it's actually really very good. Isn't
yeah.
It?
Well, let's talk somewhere else. But I think it's not just about the relationship with the licensing authority. I think sure. it's also with Islington as a whole and with Islington Council as a whole is perhaps more.
Sure. But I do want
when
to
the future it gets brighter for
idea.
You, which I'm sure it will, to make sure that it continues to be.
Yeah.
It's probably a good idea.
But it is important. I just want to get that out there that we're not this like problem child that's sitting there. Like really weird
no,
in
no,
the corner.
Of course not.
It's
no,
like, I know
no,
you know that,
no.
but it's important to say to you know our but relationship with Islington Council is actually
no, but I've got
very
kids.
Good.
I've got kids on my estates who would gnaw their arm off to have an opportunity to do the sort of stuff you know that you were saying that you were doing with yeah. with Hackney kids. Why don't you you know? Be like, I want you to do it with Islington kids too.
We will do it when we open.
When you reopen, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You heard it here.
That's a
promise. I'm going to move on to the audience Q&A, because we started late, we need to move on to them. There are a number of Fabric residents, past and present, other club owners, and a lot of fairly distinguished people in the audience. So I'm going to give the first question over to George Hull from Bloc, and then we'll just go round, and if you want to ask a question, put your hands up. Thank you, Goldie, but we've got it. Cheers.
Hello, I've got a question for Emily. The 2003 Licensing Act, which was brought in under the Blair government, made provision for 24-hour licences, although very few have ever actually been issued. Fabric, to their credit, ran one for many years. Do you think that London would benefit from more 24-hour licences being permitted by local councils? And if so, where?
I think what's interesting about that 2003 legislation was that, as we've said, you know, it was something with checks and balances. It was brought in a great fanfare. The idea was it was going to be 24-hour cafe culture if the local authorities or if the local people wanted it. I think that we found in an awful lot of areas people do not want to have it. And so although the power is there for the local authorities have not agreed to it. I think there's always a certain amount of pressure, leaving club culture aside, right? There is a pressure, for example, on Upper Street, right, where the young of London come to, you know, on a Friday and Saturday night. I've been out with people not from Islington who've known the restaurants in Upper Street better than I have, because they go there more regularly than I do. And they're not Islington people. But we provide a service for the whole of London. And there is, you know, continuing issues about how late these restaurants should be allowed to open and how long they should be allowed to sell alcohol for, given that there are people who live above the shops and around Upper Street. And it's just a continuing tension, you know.
Would
the
you
powers
like to
are there, and the important thing is that the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker apply the law fairly on behalf of the whole community.
Would you like to see any more 25 licences being issued in Islington, or would you really rather they were further afield?
I think the problem is that I have the least amount of green space of any MP in the entire country. All my constituents live on top of each other. There are very few areas where, you know, if someone's up until 3 a.m, you don't keep someone else up. And this is one of the few areas that we have. So no, I suspect it's hard. there will be problems in an area as compact as mine.
Is it not that everybody has the right to use the city in the way they find fit?
Of course.
Yeah.
No, of course.
So of course there needs to be a balance, but saying okay, you can't go out 3 at night because there's other people sleeping. I think everybody has a right to use the city in the way they like it.
Yeah, but I mean it's and it's a question of, you know, making sure that when you do what you want to do without impinging on other people's rights, and it's always a question of balancing those things. I have a right to sleep at 3 a.m, you have a right to be out at 3 a.m, so how do we work that together? And probably in some of the more overpacked areas of London, there are fewer venues of readily available, you know, for people to be up all night.
Okay, thanks George, and sorry I insulted you in the intro. Who's the next question?
Hi, it's a question for Emily as well. Hi, Emily. My name's Tom. I'm from the Nighttime Industry Association.
It's climbed out, sunshine. That's it.
It's comedy.
Next.
So we've got a campaign called Save Nightlife, and part of the campaign is involved with people signing a petition, and every single signature sends a message to people's local MP or their local councillor. One of the things we struggled to do is to engage with councillors and MPs in a meaningful way. What suggestions have you got in terms of ways that we can engage with them and have, you know, conversations like this so that change can happen?
I think you should invite them to the venues. I think maybe you're not at the larrier end of the night, but you should invite them to the venues and you should talk to them that way. And you should take, you know, because I think that then it becomes real. So, and I was explaining earlier about, you know, our system of having MPs. One of the most valuable things we have in our democracy is that we are absolutely grounded in our patch. You know, I am really proud of representing Islington South and Finsbury. This is the right on the edge of Finsbury. And I'm the MP for Fabric, and I'm the MP for this area. So other parts of the nighttime economy up and down the country, those nightclubs, those pubs, those clubs have their own MPs, and they need to make sure they get a relationship, invite them in.
Yeah. So one of the things we've noticed, certainly in venues across the UK, all it takes is one person to make a complaint about a venue. And we've heard of venues that have been actually shut down because of one person's complaint.
Yeah.
Now, we literally have hundreds, and in some cases thousands of people writing to their MPs to say, you know, how important night culture is. How can we make it so that these letters are taken in the same way that these complaints are taken?
Yeah, I think that this kind of brings us back to the issue that we've been discussing, you know, for most of the afternoon. It is a very difficult issue, and I think that in the long run, it's obviously to the advantage of businesses to make sure that they have as many friends in the real friends in the local community as possible. So if they are valued, you know, by those who are elected representatives who are just supposed to be there to represent their community, you've got to make sure that the elected representative understands that businesses are an important part of that community too. So it isn't something you can just kind of leave until there's a crisis. I think it has to be an ongoing thing.
In terms of ward councillors, there does seem to be a kind of dwindling electoral turnout in local elections. And do you think there might be a perception that some councillors don't see club goers as people who are within their constituency and people who they have a responsibility to represent?
Well, I know that in Islington we have a really high turnout, relatively speaking, in elections, but I think that young people don't get involved in politics in the way that they should. I think there are a whole load of reasons why young people should be involved in politics. I think they are completely getting the wrong end of the lollipop. I mean, I just think that time and time again, my generation is the greedy generation, and, you know, we've got the pension funds and we've had the, you know, the grants and we've eaten all the fish and we've warmed up the planet. And, you know, you have a lot of reasons for young people to be angry and to be voting, and they don't. And yes, they may also feel that part of that is that their culture is under attack by politicians who don't represent them sufficiently. So do you know what? Collectively, they have quite a lot of power. It's about time they started using it.
Wouldn't it be a good idea if you bought a flat that was next to a nightclub, which you knew people were going to be coming out at 3 a.m. or whatever? If you buy a flat there, your complaint about the noise is invalid, because if you buy a flat next to an airport, you're going to have plane noise. If you buy, you know, next to a power station, you're going to have plane noise, you know, power station noise. It's like, if you buy it there, you move in next to a nightclub, surely you should not have a say in what the sound.
I think that's a really big issue, and I think that established pubs that have been open for 100 years in a street,
yeah,
and you'll get somebody who, or a pub with a club in it at the back, you know, and it's been going, yeah, for a long time, and someone buys it knowing it has a great big pub, yeah, sign outside, yeah, and they buy a house next door, and then they start.
You should not have a say in.
I hear you. I think it's a problem.
I'm going to pass this on next. And can everyone who gives a question just give, for the benefit of people at home, who they are and what they represent or do?
Hi there, Carl Loban, DJ Magazine. First of all, I'd like to say to Cameron that the whole clubbing community is behind the Save Fabric campaign, and we all hope that the club does reopen in due course in a few weeks' time. But I've got a question for Mirik. As the nightmare of Amsterdam, what advice would you give to the incoming Night Czar, who's going to be newly appointed to Sadiq Khan, the Mayor of London's office, about what work he should be doing with different agencies, and what difficulties do you anticipate them encountering?
Yeah, so I think what I've been thinking over the last days is if all the power is with the councils and they can revoke licenses and the mayor can't interfere, can't even mediate between the sides, then it will be can be pretty difficult for a Night Czar, to be honest, for a Night Czar, if he, like, we're working, I think that's good, and also you see this also, for example, with Club Commission in Berlin, they also said they want to move more from an association to an independent organization. Like, we're independent, so we can really work both sides, and we really can get the confidence of both sides, and then work together to find a mutual solution, or find a solution which will benefit both sides. So this is one thing I was thinking on. If it's so the Night Czar will definitely have a challenge. If you're working under the mayor, then you're also maybe restricted in some ways. And this is one thing I was thinking of. But coming to the difficulties, because I think it will go the way it's planned now, and I think that's a good thing, because finally, and of course this is a big crisis, but now finally the dialogue or the debate or the discussion is now finally there, you know, about London's nightlife, and I think that's so important, because then you guys can all, everybody here and everybody who's watching, can really change something in London. So the difficulty will be definitely getting all the councils aboard, raising their level of awareness, raising their level of knowledge, raising their level of the cultural value of nightlife. There lies the key in changing this around. And also, which is also really important, is that, like, everybody has to get behind this night czar or nightmare as well. And if somebody is expecting that, and of course, after what you heard today, I think it's not. But like, if the Night Czar will think he's just going to wave your magic wand around and change the whole scene and change everything, so that will not happen. So we have to focus on, okay, how can the Night Czar with small steps improve the nightlife, and run pilots that can maybe then spill out to the rest of London, so you can have better policies for your nighttime economy and late night culture, because it's not only about the economy, it's also really about the cultural side of it.
Who is next?
Hi, I'm Keith Riley. I'm a co-founder of Fabric with Cameron. I want to bring the debate back to the part of, if you like, current licensing law, which seems to be going wrong, and how it's executed. When you were speaking about it earlier, we were talking about whether those councillors are qualified or have the ability to make such a decision and should be have such drastic powers at their hands. When it was we're talking about, it was discussed, we had what I think the analogy was a butcher, baker and a candlestick maker. We didn't have a butcher, a baker and a candlestick maker. We had a young lady that looked like she was really bullied. We had a chair of the meeting that could barely read from a written paper. And we had an ex-prison warder who's the most sanctimonious, biased person. Now, that panel should have been impartial and unbiased. And trust me, the whole world is looking at that, is looking at Islington and thinking that they have sat and presided over an entirely corrupt process. How are we supposed to engage with people that conduct themselves like that? And how I'll leave that as the question. How do we engage and how do we improve relationships with people like that? And they've allowed themselves to be used as a blunt tool to club us in pretty much the same way. They're just listening to exactly what the police said without questioning it, without challenging us, interrogate the hell out of us. It's almost like they made exactly the same mistake that the Sun made in Liverpool over Hillsborough. They just listened to exactly what the police said and they've been paying for it ever since.
I mean, listen, I'm not a councillor. I wasn't there. So it's hard for me, really, to answer it, but I will do my best. I think that imagine yourself being a councillor where a couple of youngsters have died in your patch and the police come along and give you unequivocal, you know, evidence. This club's not safe because of this, this and this. It's a challenge. It's really difficult for them, I think. I think it's really difficult. And I think that what is important when talking to licensing authorities, and I understand the politics of it. Listen, I'm a politician. I understand the politics of it. I understand the cultural importance of it. I understand the campaign. But maybe the important thing to do is to focus on what the preoccupations of that committee were, what it was that they needed to hear Fabric talk about. And if that had been focused on completely, it might have been easier. But I understand your anger, and I understand why people were saying this is so important. They must understand that it's about much more than just this. But maybe because the committee had to make a decision just on particular grounds, that it would have been good just to focus on that.
Go on. You have a total right to reply, obviously.
I do accept that, but when you said they have to listen and almost take on face value what the police are saying, they must at some point think about the implausibility of it. Everything the police are saying in this small moment, this snapshot, it flies entirely off the face of our 17 years history and all of the relationship we had with us before. And the panel was entirely driven by that one guy who's his view, and his views are quite well known, okay? It just doesn't seem fair at all. And I don't know where we go from that. Look at the implausibility of that, that all of a sudden you've just got these six statements which seem entirely different to all of that history and everything else that's ever been said about this club. In one of those statements, it says that everybody is walking around here looking like zombies and red-eyed. I would like you to look at all of the press articles and everything that's been published. Look at all the photographs and look at all the video. Does that look like some kind of Victorian asylum where people are wandering around like zombies? No, they're not. You look at every photograph. They're young people enjoying themselves, caught in a moment of music. And it is entirely wrong for them to just to sit and listen to this and unchallenged the police evidence, because it's just... The product of it is to give an unfair, biased, and I would use the word corrupt decision. And that's what's happening.
Ironically, there's more. Ironically, the guy on the prison guy who was Bensonville, I think, or was it?
Pentonville.
Quite strange, I find, ironic, really, that this guy on the prison, who was from, you know, the prison situation, there's more drugs in prisons in this country.
We had to sit there and listen to him telling us.
I find that really, really, really ironic.
Yeah. But we had to sit there and listen to that fellow telling us how wonderful dogs are and how well they work. Look at what he's done in his prison. Didn't work for him, did it? And we have to sit there and we can't answer that. And so that whole process, if you like, and this only changed in 2007. Normally, a meeting or a summary review like that would have been held in a magistrate's court. Now it's been placed in the hands of councillors, and if councillors are going to handle it in that way, that's where I think you're going to have a massive, massive problem with licensing law going forward.
But that's why I think challenging the, you know, what the disputed evidence about whether the place was safe or not, and focusing on that was the important thing. I have to tell you, just, I mean, I write to Pentonville Prison quite a lot about drugs being thrown over the wall, about them using drones, and about drugs going over with fish hooks on it, and prisoners throwing out sheets out of their window to pick up the bundles of drugs and bring it in. Pentonville has big problems with drugs, and they're in my constituency as well.
It's a really clear message that that's putting out, that regardless of what it is, and I think this is, we spoke to you about this earlier on, that I find really fascinating looking at the history of drugs in the country generally, 1900s and gin houses and opium dens and high-end women buying syringes to do drugs in this country. I get it. It's a very hedonistic country from the very beginning of time. We know that. And it just seems really weird in a society where it's so fast forward, so iPhone 7, whatever it may be, you know, designers and fashion, that it's just, I think that these people are so out of touch. And if you've got more drugs in the local prison than you have in a nightclub, it seems really strange. And tragically, you know, I think Fabric and everyone that works at Fabric, we all felt sad in that situation. It's really tragic these kids died. It really is, because for whatever their journey was or whatever, however that's transcended, it's really bad. It's awful. But I think it's one of those situations where you've got to question society and the people in charge of what's happening with councillors when they can't see that situation. And in 5 or 6 years, when this has an effect, are they even going to be retired and not even thinking about it? Are they going to be held responsible for this situation, for the economy of this place and everything else? And it's accountability, isn't it? Because we are taxpayers. And it's accountability for these people to really serve us as we serve them. And I think these people on this panel, but from what I've heard in the last 2 weeks, it's shocking. And it should be reviewed. It should be looked at in a real court of law and show us the real evidence of what's happened here with this situation.
I'm going to move the questions on, but I completely agree.
Hi, I'm Luis Manuel Garcia. I'm actually a lecturer at the University of Birmingham, but I also work on electronic music, which is why I'm here. And I have a question for the whole panel, although maybe one or two of you might be more motivated to respond to this. But a little moment ago, Dan made this really great point that it's difficult to make the kind of cultural legacy argument to a licensing board, in the sense that it's just a different set of arguments and a different set of priorities, and they just might not even listen to that kind of an argument. But then at the same time, the ruling, when it was read out against Fabric and in support of the revocation, it's the Flora Williamson's statement started with this phrase that there is a culture of drug taking, et cetera, et cetera. So this sort of raises the question of what kind of culture are we talking about, what counts as culture and what doesn't count as culture. And so my question for everybody is, what kind of ways do you see, what strategies do you see for kind of translating this cultural argument, which is you know, very important for most of the people here, in a way that's legible to the people who enforce law and make law and so on?
What's the answer to that? I mean, I've got a really bad analogy, which is the only thing I've really come up with to try and explain to people that if there's no Fabric, you might not like house, you might not like techno, you might not like drum and bass, but if there's no Fabric, then everyone loses out, because Fabric enriches all of us in London, and nightclubs and night culture enriches all of us in London, even if we don't go raving. So the question is the best analogy I've got is Adele, which is our biggest musical export, who's number one in hundreds of countries, and she's a massive success story. And I think if you look at her record label, which is XL Records.
Clubs.
So XL Records started in 1991, 92, making like hardcore drum and bass. They put out all the Prodigy albums, and then they've obviously since gone on to put out
loads
of people. The white stripes of being major artists.
So I think it's a really, if you look at that journey and if you look at how a company has formed in an underground sort of dance culture, and how the people who've run that label have then been informed by this idea about just believing in music that maybe not anyone else gets, but you're passionate about it. And I think if you build a record company based on that, you end up having this amazing 25-year journey where you're responsible for Adele. But that's something that is tangible. And I think there's probably a ton of examples where our culture, our night culture, goes on to inform culture at large. And I'm pretty sure that a lot of Adele fans have never heard the first Prodigy release and may not be aware of SL2 on a ragga tip. But the fact is, it's all part of a kind of lineage that is supported by nightclubs. And I think what Goldie was saying is really important, because we might not really see the effects of this in 5 or 10 years time. But in 20 years time, there's just going to be a load of big shiny buildings with no one who can afford to live in them.
Well, the other analogy is that, in the terms of what you're saying, to the general public who can't quite fathom this culture thing, they can't get their heads around it. They can't. But they've got to look at the way that it works with the London Dungeon or the, you know, Fleet Street and all these kind of, you know, places that were celebrated by the macabre of British people, pulling people apart. I mean, just over the road, he was hung, drawn and quartered, wasn't he? The guy from Scotland? Hung, drawn and quartered. People go out there with cameras, Japanese people, everyone, different kinds of people, taking pictures. This is people, 100 years later, celebrating the macabre of what British people did to other people and chopped them up in pieces. And we're talking about culturally displacing a club that was, in their terms, making everyone happy for the night or over a period of years. And they just can't understand that the cobblestones of London, if they're removed, people love London for that very reason. I really tried to get my head around this whole thing about what was so important about London, because I was from the Midlands. But I would go into New York, went to Miami, and then came back to London and thought, London's amazing. Because culturally, in a place where we're at this crossroads with Europe and the music that's come out from XL and all these different people, from Adele to Sheeran to Jazzy B to Aswad to UB40. I mean, culturally, there's nowhere else in the world like it. And all of those people on that journey started in clubs. But trying to translate the idea to those guys is, you take away the pyramids, you don't have any history at all because of the pyramids, right? And I'm sure people died and built the pyramids. And it's history right now as far as the club's concerned. I know it's whatever it may be, but it's very, very important that they can kind of try and take away their rose-tinted glasses of old and look at what this does for the economy. And those people are going further afield. Food's changing. People are getting really obscure in Shoreditch with what they want to eat now. Brazilian, you know, all this mad kind of different kind of foods that weren't here before. So society is adapting and changing. And that's what Fabric was way ahead of the curve by doing, providing a platform for international DJs. When we first heard about Fabric, International Superclub Hour, whatever, and then it was like, hang on a minute, there's people flying in to play in this club. You couldn't hear that unless you went there. Do you know what I mean? So it's really important that the effect has taken, that's taken. Sevens, you know.
I'll tell you what, this week, seeing Skepta winning the Mercury Music, you know, we've been showcase, we didn't make his career and we certainly haven't necessarily won in that award, but we've been supporting them from 2009, 2008 I'd say, in putting them on regularly throughout the year over time and helping those guys, incubating their scene. We're not responsible, you know, in terms of the history
incubation
of drum,
yes,
and
very
in terms of drum
work.
And bass and where drum and incubation, bass was in the late 90s, and you know, we that was our very first night. Planet V was the drum and bass night, our very ever first night at Fabric, and has been part of the mainstay of what we've done here all the way through. And it's been that support and that incubation of artists and of scenes that have allowed them and given them platform to be able to stabilise, to grow, to fuse.
And also those clubs that used to happen, and I don't want to name them, in this area, where on a couple of Sundays I've seen, you know, police evidence and there's people shot in the head hanging out of a car. I saw the pictures, different things that have happened in London from different clubs from north and south, and all of the kind of early postcodes that was going on, really bad. I mean, there was running riots in Hyde Park, and that people were, you didn't see that in the media. You didn't see it. But that would have been front page news for anybody. But you didn't see it because they were like, we need to cover this up because it's happened here right in the middle of town. You know, these people are being displaced and young people are angry and they'll get angrier. And I think for better wants of the word, the fabric works as the lamenting period for so much, so many people. And I understand the tragedies that happened, but think about the tragedies that brought people into the music. That they felt that they'd had loss or they'd felt something and they found a little bit. And then we talk about prohibition and we talk about all these other things that have happened. Or when people fall on hard times, generally, we lament and we go to clubs or we go somewhere. And it's happened since the 20s, man. Do you know what I mean? Blues and everything else. So I think we've got to look at the bigger picture of what this is really about. And culturally, preparing those two things you were talking about, it's as important as the cobblestones clubs are today. You try taking an iPhone 6 away from a kid, it's part of their extension of their body now. It's part of a phone. You can't, you know, you think about 20 years ago, we didn't have that. We've got to adapt to society. You try and tell your kids to get off an iPad now. My daughter's on an iPad. Like, I'm trying to tell her to get off it. Shit's changing. If that's the case, go and live in the woods if you want that. And if you don't live in an area where there's a club, go and live out of town. You buy a bigger house. Do you know what I mean? So it's kind of like, I don't get it. I really don't get it.
I'm going to pass over to Alex now.
Just to link it back to the question, and in terms of what can we do so that councillors recognise that cultural impact, part of the excellent work that the NTIA has been doing is to change the perception of what nightlife means. And everything that the guys have been talking about, from XL and Fabric as an incubator, we now have Skepta and Adele. We need to make those links publicly. We need to say, we have this, so we get this. It's in your living room. It's not something scary in the shadows. Hundreds of thousands, millions of people enjoy this culture and look at all of the benefits it brings. Attitudinal shift, change the way that people think about it. Hopefully, when it comes to that deliberation, then they'll be better disposed towards them.
Who has the next question? Who's got next?
Yeah, we are liking about this.
I was just thinking about this idea of a plan. Oh, sorry, my name's Jack Horner, and I've ran a music marketing agency about as long as these boys have been running Fabric for. So we've put on events all around the world in London and have come across some similar challenges with licenses and stuff. But my thought was really about this plan for London, which was mentioned a few times earlier on, which I think is important. And it dawned on me that 4 years ago, it was London 2012, and we opened that ceremony, if everyone remembers, with Danny Boyle, man most famous probably for directing Trainspotting, and we know what the content of that film was, and Underworld, right? So we're more than happy to, as a nation, put on stage, you know, and use electronic music and electronic music culture and all the things that that's born. And we put it on stage and we wave it around like a flag, right? Yeah, you're involved. other celebrities in the room. And we wave these people like a flag. And there was a parallel event called Great is Britain, or This is Britain is Great, or something, that kind of was running along the same time as the Olympics. And it was bringing together people like us lot, and we'd all kind of sit in various palaces around London, sort of, you know, being put on show to say this is what London and culture is all about. What I can't quite understand is why there is no plan for London. Like, we know that it's not new, Fabric's not new. You know, we know the value of music export from the UK internationally. We've just Brexited, for Christ's sake. You know, we really need right now to stand up and say we embrace our culture and we will, you know, we'll do everything to stand behind it. And I think this is a huge failing to do that in the part of whatever systems it is. And I know there's lots of details to whose responsibility it might be. I want to know where this plan for London comes from.
Coordinating the many different boroughs is actually a big plank of NTIA policy, to try to bring together all of the boroughs and look at consistent decision making and also look towards a citywide plan as well, which we've talked about a lot today.
I think a lot of venues have over the past kind of 10 years not actually been that good at coordinating resources and trying to take some ownership of the conversation. Everyone's sort of been doing their own thing to a certain extent. I mean, I know that people collaborate on a very, very local level, but I think one of the things that I think with the NTIA that Alan's done is is actually form a group, form a voice, and start having an impact on what the national conversation about these things is, and having somewhere for people, if you want to talk to venues, having some kind of representative. But I think the venues and the NTIA, and we have, you know, we have to have a plan for London, and I think that has to come from venues as much as from councillors and from City Hall and people like that, because I think everyone actually wants the same thing out of this, which is a safe but culturally and economically and socially successful nighttime economy that we can all be proud of. And I think councillors, MPs, operators, everyone actually wants the same thing. We're just coming at it from slightly different angles.
There's no reason that operators can't take the lead in that, and there's no reason that operators shouldn't be, just like Cameron, proposing these changes that they think are going to benefit the industry. I just really, really hope that the councillors listen.
I'd like to hear from Emily, because she is someone who actually represents our interests technically on a big stage.
I think there's it's been a really interesting conversation, this, about power and about who has power and how they exercise it and in the interests of who. And that's what politics is about. Politics is about power. And when you say, you know, where does this plan come from? It comes from politics. It comes from a Labour mayor, I'm afraid, who was elected in May and who puts this forward as a priority, who has, you know, it's, and politics is about, you know, what priorities you have. I'm not quite sure what Boris's priorities were, but they weren't that, you know, and he was fairly hands-off. But I believe that politics can make a difference and is the exercise of power in the right way. And yeah, people make mistakes and, you know, it needs to be sorted out. And you're right, actually, power is best exercised when it's properly informed and when you get the industry working with politicians to make sure that we make the decisions in the right way.
Hopefully the new Nightstar can work on
exactly
help that as well.
Exactly.
Cool. Who has got the next question? Do you want to start up?
Hi, I'm Kerry. I'm a DJ and I love fabric. And I find it odd we even need to debate the cultural significance of the club, because the issue... I feel like, why do we even need to debate the cultural significance of the club? Because the issue here is that they are one of the safest venues in the UK. It was obviously unfortunate and tragic what happened, but they could not have prevented it. They've done everything they can. Do you know what I mean? Like, this could have happened anywhere. It just happened to happen here.
Yeah, it feels a little bit like Alcoholics Anonymous, where all together we're saying we've all seen it, and it's tragedy, and it's still out on that.
That's true.
But I think the positive aspect of this discussion, not in this room, but actually what's now seeped out into the mainstream press, is that people who aren't involved in clubs, who actually have no interest in clubs, are actually saying this is a really troubling precedent, shutting a venue, which is actually, it's just suddenly hit a lot of people that, hold on, this is a cultural institution. And I don't think it's us trying to necessarily tell the world, it's the world suddenly on the outside realising, oh my God, this is like the Tate or the Royal Opera House.
Yeah, which it is. Or the Royal Albert Hall. I agree with that. But what I'm saying is this issue is about...
Are we going to let her talk?
10 years. 10 years.
Excuse me, are we going to let her talk? She's asking a question. You both interrupted her. I'm just saying.
I've been coming here for 10 years.
You're still doing it?
I started DJing because of coming to this club. And I just think... The actual issue here really isn't about whether it's cultural or not, and I do agree it is cultural. The issue is that they're one of the safest clubs in the UK, if not Europe, if not the world, and what happened is obviously tragic and sad, but it could have happened anywhere.
Yeah, and no other profession is held up to the standards that clubbing is.
It could have happened on an aeroplane or in Sainsbury's, and that wouldn't have had the same effect, and that's what it's sad, and my heart goes out to the families of these children, but... You know, you cannot hold the club accountable for that. You really can't. And that's what I think the real issue is.
Yeah, so I totally agree with you, of course. But the thing is, like, to get something done, you need to speak the same language. And so that's why Raw of the Nightside could really help, because then you can speak the same language as the people in City Hall, as the councillors. And so that you get to this level in which you don't have to have this debate anymore, whether it's culture or not. But to get to that position, they need to invest a lot to get there. And hopefully, and also coming back to the question before, the cultural and economic value should be like have an economic impact research on the value of nightlife, but also on the cultural impact. And if we really can have that, then we can really have a debate with politicians about the value of nightlife. But I don't think there's a standard. Hopefully, in the future there will be an international standard how to.
But I don't understand the cultural value. What can they expect this club to do more than they're doing? They're already doing more than most clubs. Emily? Maybe that's a question for you.
I think one important point is that the first thing that these councillors, if you like, heard about Fabric was that someone had died.
Yeah.
They don't know about this. They know nothing about it. So the first thing, so instantly it's a bad place. It's a terrible place, you know, that we've got to stop this. And they don't know. And what you said earlier on about getting them here, you know, unfortunately they can't now because they've shut it. But, you know, it's... If they could have come in and seen it, you know, it would have made a difference, I think, because they don't know anything about it. They don't know, they haven't seen it. All they hear about is that first bit of bad news and they have to do something about it.
That kind of broken perspective is really, really like critical, that if you have someone who's like, oh, there are kids going to this big place to die,
yeah,
versus we do everything in our fucking power to be stringent and check and have a like fractional amount of people that have died in 16 years, you have like a base level problem because those are two opposing sides which aren't going to meet in the middle. Guys, I'm sorry, we're going to have to move on to the next question because we're running out of time slightly.
Hi, my name's Howie. I'd like to ask Cameron... I have to stand up. I was standing up. Hi. Hi, my name's Howie. I'd like to ask Cameron a question. Once you've got this decision overturned over the next couple of months, Fabric opens up again. Do you see Lenore 2 happening again? Like a Lenore 2, like something like that happening?
It's a very good question. And the truth is, if we are fortunate enough to get open, I think the first thing is we would want to rebuild that relationship with the police. And when we came out of that hearing in December last year, we had a reset meeting in the February this year. And we literally all hugged, metaphorically. And we left that room agreeing that we would never find ourselves in court again, that we would always get round the table. And it took, what, 3.5 months for that agreement to be broken without us knowing it. So there is a lot for us to repair. And I do honestly believe Islington Council, we have a great relationship with the licensing team there. And I believe wholeheartedly there is an appetite to want to work with us. And I believe there's a mainstay of the police that do. But I'm afraid there is a fundamental issue with that central licensing team, the Operation Lenore team, and that would be something we would have to look to the Mayor's office to try to navigate that that challenge, because I honestly think if they were motivated last time, if we get open next time, I think they'll be doubly motivated, and I think there needs to be a proper reset meeting, brokered by the Mayor, enforced by the Mayor, and in some way protected, that we're doing our responsibility and they're doing their responsibility and that we can work together, because that's the way I can only see it happening, because I do fear for it.
We have time for one final question, and it's an important man, Alan Miller, who runs the NTIA, who kind of co-chairing this entire debate. Go take it away, Alan.
Thank you, Gabe. There's been some really great salient points, and I think it really demonstrates over the last couple of years what we've been talking about, which is really, on the one hand, the backward thinking that associates nightlife with crime and antisocial behaviour, not with where we get inspired, where we fall in love, or where the next great artists come from. And that's why the hearts and minds conversation is really important that Mirik made. And you've all made very salient points. I think, Emily, your point about politics is absolutely true and absolutely right. And that's why I want to sort of encourage people to do a couple of things. But before I do that, I think it's important to say the things that we have won as well. In the last period, we've created a nighttime commission with the Mayor's Office for London. Now, I know people were very frustrated about what was happening during Fabric. But on there is the police and the TfL and housing and theatres and a whole range of stakeholders, because in the end, we have to work together. This is about how we shape London for the next two decades, but also across the UK, our cities. They're our cities, right? And we need to be at the table and we need to be having our voices heard and say, don't punish us for personal behaviour. Don't hold venues accountable when someone does something like you don't do with Canberra Sands and you don't do on the motorway. But at the same time, we have to recognise how we work together. The police have a lack of resources. Don't just be stats obsessed and say, yeah, we close that down and that's a benefit. recognize the pressure under them. They're being asked to do all sorts of things like terrorism, cybercrime. They've got less money. Let's understand that. Sit at the table, bring everyone together and shape the future of London. Now, one of the things we can all do within that, not just the industry, but all the people are watching, is that they can, as well as supporting Fabric, they can come on to savenightlife.com and they can send their messages to their MPs and councillors. Because like when we did a campaign around Hackney and thousands of people said, no, it's not acceptable to have a curfew. It's not acceptable to say no more clubs are appropriate. And actually the people, the residents, we in the UK say that's not acceptable and we want to see something different, and they have to listen. So the point about politics and power is we can galvanise the support. All the young people that didn't vote and want to have a say, and it's our responsibility to come to the table and have people who understand the nuances and also say it's not acceptable to hold proper British businesses accountable for individual personal behaviour and work out how we move forward in partnership. It's going to be very embarrassing, I think, for a lot of people, sadly, during the appeal. A lot of things are going to come out. And I, for one, didn't want this situation. But now we're here. And the important thing is how we move forward. So obviously save Fabric, but also save Nightlife, and let's have everyone get involved with that.
Cool. I don't need this. We are sadly out of time because we started late and various people have other things to do. Obviously, we weren't going to save Nightlife in a 2.5 hour panel discussion, but I hope people at home have enjoyed the chat and kind of gleaned something new from it. Can everyone please give a warm hand to our fantastic panellists? As Alan said, just keep your eyes on the debate, and especially if you're someone who's my age or younger, as many watch the boardroom are, please actually enter into the discussion, make your voice heard, because we're going to be in this position one day. But hopefully not this specific position. All right, cheers.